So, Elena, let's hand it over for the closing session to you.
Okay, thank you. Can you see my screen or I need to swap this place?
We can see everything, yeah.
So you see you see a slide, right? Not presented.
Yeah, European HDF Users Group.
Okay, so I will use just probably a few minutes to talk about our plans and let me see how I... Okay, here it is. So I will just give you update on HDF5 library, where we are going, so you will be aware of what we coming with. So just remind you that our latest releases you can download from our web pages. And now it is 1.8.22, 1.10.7, and 1.12.1 should be imminent. We're almost ready. We're working on the web pages. And those are maintenance releases. They usually include bug fixes. And recently we started working very actively on severe vulnerability issues that we discovered during fuzzy testing when file is intentionally corrupted. And few deficiencies in the library were discovered. So we're working on removing those. Upcoming releases will be one in 1.10.8, so it will be in 1.10 series, and 1.8. We're still supporting applying CVEs fixes and when appropriate bug fixes. What it will be new, we're coming with so-called unstable line of releases from the develop branch. And they will, we call them now 1.13, with the first one will be 1.13.0, will be just in a few seconds. And the goal with those releases to deliver new capabilities that we're working on, that will be in the next major maintenance line of releases, which currently is labeled as 1.14. So those unstable releases, they are fully tested. They will be available on all platforms with one caveat that API still can be changed and file format, there still can be changes in between versions 1.13x and 1.13x plus one. So we leave this binary and file format incompatibility in the releases. So what we're working toward 1.14 and what will be available in those upcoming 1.13 releases. First of all, it is enhancement to compression and especially in compression used by parallel applications. We know that it scales. We know there are some problems at very large scales. And as we learn here, there are some problems with write performance of compression data sets. We're actively profiling, but my appeal to you, if you have application that really you think is slow, please send us so we can lead to the bottom of performance problems. Last HUG meeting, which we had at fall, we talk about a lot of newly developed HDF5 wall connectors. And you know that in 1.12, we release HDF5 wall layer that captures calls to HDF5 library and directs it to the wall connector. And wall connector can be pass-through wall connector that just does something with your data and then goes back to HDF5 native library, or it goes to directly to different type of storage like DEOS storage or cloud storage. So we are finalizing HDF5 wall APIs, including there are now HDF5 wall APIs to support asynchronous operations with HDF5 wall connectors. And this will be in 1.13.0 release. We're also actively working on having our VFDs dynamically loaded as we have filter plugins. And they will be first GPU VFD based on NVIDIA GPU. So new features that will be coming later, it is subfiling for parallel applications, VFD swimmer, onion VFD, and stay tuned. All those features will be, when we kind of, they are available in the release, we'll have webinars. So if you are interested to learn more, please watch for announcements and we will have next series of webinars will be on HDF5 walls. So all the successes of HDF5 will absolutely not possible without a strong community that contributes to HDF5. We're now on GitHub And we already got some very nice optimization, performance optimizations. One of them is in develop branch. If you iterating through many chunks in HDFI file, there is much faster iteration function that is available now. Also, we treat documentation, especially reference manual, as part of code. We added it to Doxygen, and we hosted along with our previous documentation, which is on Confluence, through S3 bucket. And we will be very happy if you go and look and contribute to documentation. Now it's part of the code. Just go to GitHub, do pull request, and we'll be more than happy to accept your contributions. We started running H5Pi regression testing in-house using develop branch of H5Pi and our HDF5 develop branch. So finding incompatibilities early and alerting H5Pi people. So please report any issues you found and propose improvements, including improvements to documentation. Just open an issue on GitHub or contact help at hdfgroup.org. We also have TG clinics every Tuesday. Bring your topics. We encourage you to attend our webinars. And please, if you want to present, we'll be more than happy to host your webinar and your blogs. And there will be another HUG meeting targeting US audience on October 12, 16. So it will be maybe not very convenient time for Europeans, but if you can attend, please. So what is our wish list? Many things were already kind of said here. One of our wish lists, we really want to focus on improving our documentation, including user documentation, and what is more important, even internal documentation. So in hope to get more contributions to HDF5 software, so it will be easy for new users to start and learn about HDF5 and start contributing. We are very well aware of several performance issues, and VDS performance was mentioned. We looked at VDS performance, and it boils down to how selection algorithm broke in HDF5. So hopefully when we improve hyperslab selection, Lena mentioned 1D selection in her use case. So we want to look on this. And of course, when we moved and added more features to 110 and 112, you got this on this graph of a huge performance spike with the first releases, performance degradation. And we put a lot of effort to remove this gap between performance of 1.8 and 1.10 and later, and Mathrox brought one of those use cases. We have another use cases. So please, we encourage you to move to new releases, but please let us know if you experience any performance issues when you're moving from 1.8 to 1.10. Applications most affected are applications that deal with a lot of metadata. So we're looking into those use cases and trying to remove the gap. Another topic that came up frequently, but surprisingly it was not here, it is multi-threaded HDF5 libraries. So we are looking and we hope to work with community on working toward implementation of full multi-threaded library. Also, there is a very nice project that community can help us with. It is full support for UTF encoding. We internally have very good understanding what needs to be done, and we just need, you know, hands and bandwidth to implement it. And of course, avoiding file corruption came here many times, and John addressed already in his talk. And John Reedy addressed some things that we are working on in HDS area and in cloud. So with this, I would like to open floor for questions, suggestions. Please just unmute yourself and let's go.
Yes, don't be shy. This is it's a bit in, we tried to, with Elena, we discussed that at the last European meeting we had, like we opened the floor and let people, you know, just speak frankly about the issues or things they'd like to see. And so I think, yeah, this is the time to do it. Yeah.
It is fun section, yes, please.
Well, I'll break the ice and answer Graham Winter's question. As our snapshots cleaned up on file close, the answer is yes.
May I make a suggestion in terms of the way you handle inter-version compatibility, which is that instead of making it completely dependent on definitional things, that it be a dynamic way to do it. So if I was sitting in, say, 114 sometime in the future, I could just dynamically move writing files as 18, 110, okay? And not have to use minus D controlled builds of things. That one, you know, 130, that 114, the objective 114 would be to simply have all the dynamic hooks to read and create the older versions. So we don't need to keep the older versions hanging around or separately compiled libraries, just one master library.
And you do not need to do it right now, Herbert. I don't know, there is some kind of misunderstanding. So any new version of HDF5 library will read files created by any previous versions of the library. What may happen that if you use new features, say VDS, this requires new additions to file format, and you will need version 110 or later to read VDS file that contains VDS. But you do not need to keep old versions around to read old files.
I definitely need them for writing.
No, for writing you can use setlibver bounds function that is access property, and you can write different versions of the file within the same application using different access properties.
I'll try it. Thank you.
There's a link from Thomas Kluver in the chat.
Yeah.
With the caveat that you can use setlib for bounds, but that's only going to change what you create after calling that function.
Right. Mm-hmm.
If you've already done something that is not supported by an earlier version, it's there and you have to delete it or do something to get rid of it.
But applications can control the version of the file they're creating using latest version of the library.
Thank you.
We had, unfortunately, we didn't think it through when we started introducing those, when we moved from 1.8 to 1.10, but now we have the process, it should go seamlessly. And we also have API compatibilities, ways you do not need to move your application to use the latest version of APIs also.
There was a comment about a question if the user-defined functions that were presented by Villa in HDF5 UDF could be used from HDFQL.
Hi, this is Lucas. I cannot speak for HDFQL, but overall, the data that you encode as UDF is mostly the same as a data set that's compressed by a regular filter. So as long as HDFQL is able to read data compressed by, say, a gzip filter, it should be able to read a data set encoded by a UDF as well.
So it sounds like yes, yeah.
Mm. Yes, that's right.
That's good. We have a
wish list which maybe with some the idea is Zdenek, you're asking if you look at the file one can discover what is the earliest version of HDF5 library that can read this file, right?
Yeah, that could be like this. Yeah, you understand. Like I meant that there are like tools, I don't remember them, like UCX info, MPI info, and we'll list you what the properties are in this like file, or it could really do what you are mentioning, that that it could be run on file and it could say what that file can do. Yeah, yeah, that's the library and the file. Yeah.
Right. Okay, noted. Good suggestion. And I think we have all information available. It's really, you know, we need to create a tool.
There is a, from my own side, I was wondering, I mean, we've had this question recently also about what optimization strategies to adopt for parallel file systems like spectrum scale.
You know, a good question. So the only thing is that, first of all, when we talk about different performance issues, there are many levels, right, of those performance. And the best thing is really have a good tool to profile. And we can recommend Darshan for sure. Now it has much better support for HDF5, and it has also Python interface. And we provide Python notebooks, so it's easy to access log files and start analyzing them. There is also a tool called for H5 recorder, and we have links on our web pages probably, and they will talk last fall on the recorder. It gives you slightly different information, but with Darshan and recorder, you get a lot of good information about HDF5 performance. And then there should be tools which my colleague may help really to look more, dig deeper into file performance, file system performance. And then when you get the whole picture, then have some strategy where to start tuning. For GPFS and Lustre systems. For GPFS, HDF5 provides one API, it's a set alignment that really we found helps for GPFS system performance, but it increases the size of your file. For Lustre system, usually you have to experiment with the stripe size and see how file is organized. And it's tuned this way, along with tuning your application and how which HDF5 features are used. But really, there's no one recipe that will fit all applications. Profile first, and let's talk.
I didn't understand your suggestion for GPFS. There's a library as a
The HDF5 library has a call H5P set alignment.
Okay.
And that call helps with performance on GPFS systems.
Okay.
I believe we have API for file locking. I'm not sure if. So Jordan or someone from HDF, do you remember which API it was? I believe it was introduced quite recently. Shame of me, I don't remember all APIs.
We would need it exposed in H5Pi as well, Valt, I think so.
Right. I will make a note, I will find.
Also understand what happens when external links are followed as well and virtual data sets, because files are being opened as well. Yeah. What do they inherit the same setting?
I do not know, John, maybe you know. I know they inherit the same file degree closing setting.
I guess they inherit the same access mode, right? That's right. What Thomas was also mentioning. So yeah. If it's append mode, it will be append mode. If it's read only, it will be read only. I guess that applies also for the locking. Maybe not.
Maybe not. I need to check. I don't know.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
It's also worth noting for external links, we do have an API where you can set a file access property list that the external file will use on file open. So you can control various file open properties with that.
Good to know.
There was a question, I don't know if John is still online, John Reddy, about future of H5PiD and that. I think what I understood from John that was frozen or what, no?
No, it's not frozen.
Okay.
So my intent is to, expose all functionality in HSGS through H5PiD. So oftentimes, we're more involved in HSGS and the H5PiD interfaces don't really need to change that much, take advantage mm-hmm. of it. For example, with the direct access mode, all you need to do is change the endpoint to local and you'll get that functionality. Mm-hmm. But I do admit that some of the more recent H5PI changes I haven't yet reflected in H5PiD. If anyone out there would like to help contribute to the effort, I certainly welcome the help.
Okay, no, I think that's still a viable option for people. Mm-hmm.
And I just posted link to API for file logging. It was introduced in 1.10.7, I believe, release. Yeah, it was in 1.10.7, so in the last 1.10 release. And so it will be available in 1.12.1.
Perfect, thanks.
Mm-hmm. From Ellen, filter plugin question, any plans to consolidate all the plugins into one truth? Well, actually we started as with this effort and then it fell apart. So Eugen Wintersberger was pushing for this. And so we ended up having our own repo that we were using for testing, but people found it very useful. We support all plugins that most of the plugins that H5PI people use and Synchrotron community. So we distributed with our binaries and I posted link to the GitHub repo. Mm-hmm. We also added, I don't know if spec is mostly used to build a software stack on HPC systems. We have variant of HDF5 that builds all plugins that we support with HDF5. There's really no good solution for this. So I don't know, it's really interesting question. What can we do here?
There was a comment made in the H4DF5 plugin talk, and I don't know if Thomas Vincent is still there, but saying there was some way that the library could help by doing some of the work that they're doing in HDF5 plugin. Thomas, are you still there? Maybe not. It's starting to get late here, but it's...
If he's not, I think I remember about this from a previous conversation. I think the thing that they want is currently they make calls into libhdf5 to get certain information about the data set. And they would kind of ideally like that when the filter is set up, that the necessary information about the data set, like the shape and the chunk shape and the data type and things like that are all passed in. I hope I'm remembering that right.
Yeah. There was some link
to
the library.
They don't have to link against
HDF5. Yeah, and I would be very interested to learn about the solution because this is one of the issues we're having with plugins. And we build our plugins mostly with CMake. And maybe a question from, but maybe here we will have more Python users. How popular CMake build system are at your facilities or for your software?
Now, in the case of most of the software that I'm involved with, where there's C++, we've moved to CMake. okay. over the last years. Mm-hmm. CMake seems to have taken over, I think. Yeah.
Unfortunately, from my perspective.
Yeah, it has the big advantage. It works the same firewalls. No,
there are definitely a lot of advantages, and but it's I think it's much messy, but it's my personal opinion. any suggestions, hot topics that we didn't discuss during this two sessions?
Enabling multi-threading, is there any news on enabling multi-threading concurrency in HDF5 since last November?
Well, we have, HDF Group took some time, we had a sponsored project that we offered our own approach. There was one approach discussed last November, and we came out with another approach. We will be publishing on GitHub. I will open the issue and we'll publish RFC, or we'll have link to our document, how we would like to approach. And John can talk more about this right now, but the idea is to make few packages inside HDF5 really multi-threaded. And as a quick workaround, have a wall plugin that supports multi-threading and allows multi-threaded concurrent reading from HDF5 file. This is in general approach. If you're interested, RFC will be available, and we really hope we can continue this discussion and see in which direction we are going. So John, would you like to add anything to this?
Yeah, you'll want to see the RFC because I lay it out in much more detail there. But it's basically suggesting we take advantage of a few recent developments. One of them is with the existing HDF5 library, it doesn't matter if your vol connector is multi-threaded, we're still going to serialize you. And it turns out with making four or five packages thread safe or multi-thread capable, we can open things up so that the vol connectors, which can support multi-threaded processing, would be able to do so. That, of course, leaves the question of what to do with HDF5 library proper. Unfortunately, retrofitting multi-thread support on existing code is always entertaining. So we want to take that very slowly. But we do have these requests for multi-threaded reads. And so the thought was that if we allow the vols to become multi-threaded, and then we go into the VFD layer and make that multi-thread capable as well, we could then start giving a temporary workaround in the form of intercepting certain API calls with a wraparound vol, which would go in and do, let's say, multi-threaded data set reads under rather limited circumstances, say starting only contiguous, things like that. But certainly from my perspective, the only reasonable approach that I see to doing this is to try and retrofit this multi-threaded support on a package-by-package basis. That's going to be slow and expensive. I have to admit, I'd be inclined to leave that one for a rewrite of the HDF5 library. But if we want something to begin with, that would be a good start. Anything you want me to add, Elena?
No, I think we should publish RFC and then have discussion. Mm-hmm. And I'm trying. I'm trying to answer the question about walls where they are registered.
In any case, that RFC I think is ready to go.
Right.
Publish mm-hmm. it whenever.
And there was a question about where one can find wall connectors which exist. So the HDF group wall connectors also have identifiers as compression filters. So I just pasted the copy and pasted the page, link to the page where those connectors are registered. And right now we have five, six connectors registered, asynchronous IO, cache, DELS, native, which is essentially it's HDF5 library at this point, pass through Redis for Redis object store and REST wall connector.
I think there was some comment. Laurie gathered the input there, so people would like to see some of the projects being mirrored or also seen as part of the contributions. Yeah.
Yeah, I just pasted in a question from the website. I don't know if you had a chance to see it in your email.
I guess maybe next step to have mini workshop on this because I don't have the answer. There was definitely no plans from TG to federate, but I think the first thing we need to improve usability of filters, especially to address this problem with linking filters with HDF5, which sometimes is not necessary. Definitely, if you need a plugin that we support for 32-bit platform, just let us know which one and we'll try to build it for you to help with this. But you can build it yourself also, just following instructions in the repo.
I had one just question was about the work that John Wright showed of GPU based compression. Could that be included as a plugin? I don't think so. No, it's difficult. Eh? GPU based compression.
So, I don't know, TG folks should chime in, but my understanding was that raw data was moved to GPU and compressed there. And this definitely can be done in the filter, but it will require some work. Jordan or John, could you please comment on this?
I'd defer to Jordan, but my understanding was that the GPU VFD was going to be the first guinea pig for pluggable, so.
But it's not for compression, right? It's for writing. This is a compression done on GPU, so our filters
Our
filters, and I don't see why not, but it definitely will require work. We do not have any filters. Said this, there is definitely efforts in some communities to add floating point, like I believe it was ZFP and SZ compressions for their lossy and lossless. They come in both variants to use GPUs, but those are still in their infancy. And as soon as there is a library that does it, then filter can be done. So it's possible. Mm-hmm. And if someone is interested to work with us, let's try, because there is huge advantage, especially when you combine a compression on GPU and direct write from GPU to storage using write chunk functions. It should be really good enhancement. And we were planning to add direct chunk writing for parallel applications too, but it is kind of on our wish list. It's not in works yet. So there is a lot of potential here.
There's a project, there's a light sources community just based to work on compression for the next 2 years. Maybe we can include that.
Yeah, it will be good to collaborate on this.
Okay.
One thing I want to add, there is a new generation of GZIP compression that we didn't have chance to look at, but this is something we'll definitely be doing because it becomes more available. And I was told it's like 10 times faster than current GZIP.
Okay. I think we, at least in our community, lossy compression is becoming more interesting because of the volume, data volumes. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And in our compression filters, we do provide both SZ and ZFP. So you may try it.
Yeah. We have it. We did
some tests. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Last year, it was much more difficult. Questions were just going around the room.
Yeah. But I think you answered many of them. So compared to the last meeting also we had in France, was there, a lot of things have been taken up by HDF Group. So we can really thank you for reacting, yeah?
Okay, then if there are no any further questions, first of all, please feel free to contact help desk, post your questions on forum, come to our clinic and attend webinars. And we will, as I just repeat, we will be glad to host your topic and have webinar or blog. So please, we'll be more than happy to do this. And thank you everyone for participating. That was amazing meeting, very interested talks. So.
Yeah, and I would also especially like to thank Laurie, did an amazing job. I had never seen a workshop put together so quickly. And Elena and Dax for being so responsive and also for the great work that you guys do. Huh?
Yeah, Andy, and thank you for pushing us to put this thing so quickly.
I'm very happy that we did it before
the holidays. Right, Ellen is asking when we have in-person meeting again, can we get tour of a synchrotron facility in Europe? This is always part of those meetings, and this is very enjoyable to go on those tours. So
that comes for free, but we had an offer, but I see she's not online at the moment. Lana was offering to organize the next face-to-face physical meeting. In ITER, which is in a lovely part of France, the south of France. Mm-hmm. And I think a visit of ITER is also very impressive.
Okay.
So thank you, everyone. Yeah.
Thank you.
Have a good day or evening. Yeah, I think we lost Danny already because he's probably, it's about 1 a.m.
Okay.
Thank you.
And goodbye and hope to hear from you. Bye-bye.
Bye.